When we talk about crypto today, a lot of the conversation is around financial rewards. But I think not enough of the conversation is focused on how crypto and its related technologies will change our future and our money.
Technologies that are old enough, people don't even realize that they're technologies. They think they're just part of the natural world. But we see over and over when innovation comes along, and it can change everything.
Innovation is all around us, accelerated by digital technologies and connected by the internet. New inventions are making older technologies obsolete at an ever-increasing rate. But what about a technology that is older than the internet, cell phones, TV, radio, cars, and electricity? The technology of money.
So money really evolved to solve the double coincidence of wants problem. You have some chickens and you want a ham, but the guy with the ham doesn't want chickens. So what do? You have to trade with somebody else. That's very complicated.
Money is one of our oldest technologies, but just like other technologies, it has gone through many iterations.
One of the most popular monies is using gold, but you gotta mine the gold, you gotta take the gold out of the ground. So there was an evolution towards fiat money or government-created money, paper money beginning in China. So the advantage of fiat currencies is you don't have to dig the gold out of the ground. The big disadvantage is that they're entirely controlled by governments.
Current money technology faces various problems. The first is the government control over the money. If governments become destabilized or corrupt officials gain control, citizens can be left with a worthless currency. The second are the institutions that keep track of all the money, the banking system.
So the banking system, precisely because it is a nexus of power, it can be taken over by corrupt systems and used against the people.
We see that the people and organizations that both create and then control the way that we're allowed to access and use money have a great deal of power over us.
But why are banks such a problem? It boils down to one thing: centralized power.
People underestimated that even though they weren't going to have people breaking into their homes and stealing from them, in giving the assets to the banks, and again with the centralized form of power, there is a much more surreptitious style of stealing.
By acting as middlemen, banks have gained enormous power. This can lead to catastrophic consequences, like the global financial crisis in 2008.
Let's talk about the speed with which we are watching this market deteriorate.
This could be the most serious recession in decades. And that means life, as most Americans know it, is about to change.
I think an issue with human control within any resource-based system is power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely.
The revolution of the internet created an opportunity for peer-to-peer digital transactions without middlemen. But at the time, the tech wasn't ready. Instead, banks have remained in the middle of nearly every transaction.
At the end of the 1970s, how many transactions did you make through your bank? You usually would buy things using cash. Now, every transaction you make through a bank, every time you use PayPal, Venmo, your credit card, you're making even tiny transactions through a bank.
We've inserted intermediaries or authorities into places where we previously simply had person-to-person interactions.
This is a foundational flaw of the internet, then, that there isn't a native payment layer. So yes, you can run your own email server and have direct mainline access right to email, but you have no mainline direct access to the ability to pay someone else online. You have to convince somebody, a for-profit corporation, to open an account for you and let you transact. This is obviously a huge problem.
Frustrated by the centralized control over our money technologies, scientists and technologists work to create a decentralized internet payment system. It was envisioned to be something like the internet itself. Digital, instant, decentralized, and fair. In 2009, this financial system became a reality.
Crypto kind of came out of nowhere, took the world by storm.
This was the fastest moving technology we have ever seen. You know, almost an order of magnitude faster than the previous fastest one, which was mobile phones.
The first iteration of this new money technology was the cryptocurrency called Bitcoin.
I remember the first time, I think it was on like Google Chat, my friend says, "Did you hear about this Bitcoin thing?" I probably should have taken it more seriously, But what I responded to him with was something like, that's a ridiculous name. This has been tried before. I'm sure this one won't work either.
I'm the author of the first blog post on the internet about Bitcoin. And in it, I say, there's a possible thing which is actually decentralized money. And then I say, and check out this attempt by this Satoshi Nakamoto guy.
Satoshi Nakamoto was an anonymous person or group. They designed Bitcoin to allow us to send money directly to anyone in the world over the internet. To do this, Satoshi invented a new record-keeping technology called blockchain.
Bitcoin uses what's called a blockchain, which you can think of as just a public database. And that database literally tracks payments from one person or another.
This is contrasted with the way like banking works today, where each bank maintains their own records in a database. And whatever they tell us, they say, oh yeah, this account has this much, that account has that much. We just have to take their word for it. And blockchain is this great innovation by Satoshi Nakamoto to replace that with something that's verifiable by everyone.
Blockchains keep track of all the transactions in cryptocurrencies. And in order to keep the blockchain record safe, it is backed up by a network of independent computers all over the world, who each have a complete and synchronized copy of all these transactions. This makes Bitcoin both decentralized and tamper-resistant.
Anyone who wants to connect to the network can get a full copy of all of the records.
And every time that one of us makes an update to the ledger, all of us makes an update to the ledger. And so we all have the same real-time view of who has what value.
So now, if anyone tries to tamper with anything, it'll be easy for you to A, find out that that's not valid, and B, find the true valid untampered history from someone else.
So I think one of the powers of decentralization is that it takes away any natural attack points.
There's no root user. You have to hack every individual user at the edges of the blockchain in order to do something. So we don't end up with this systemic vulnerability right at the heart of our critical infrastructure.
Bitcoin removed middlemen and centralized control, making a global currency that is digital, decentralized, and peer-to-peer. But despite its immense potential, Bitcoin had one severe flaw.
The problem that Satoshi set out to solve was the one that I had tried and failed to solve, which is how to make money decentralized. And the solution is we're not going to rely on any one party to keep track of things for us. Instead, everyone's going to keep track of everyone else's things. But the inevitable problem with that is then you can't use it without exposing your own private actions to everyone else on the whole internet.
And this has always been centrally the big flaw of Bitcoin. Bitcoin is a wonderful system that everybody thinks of as like anonymous money, but it's actually anything but that.
Phrase I coined a number of years ago was Bitcoin is Twitter for your bank account. Let's say you had a credit card and every time you swiped it, it tweeted the credit card transaction data. It would literally be public to everybody. And this is exactly what happens in a cryptocurrency. Every time you use it, the transaction you make is broadcast to the world for everyone to see.
Anyone back then knew, and this is the early 2010s, that Bitcoin was not private, and that someday someone's gonna have to figure out a way to build the same thing, but make it completely private.
After Bitcoin was released, Satoshi Nakamoto wrote about this flaw in a public discussion with other developers.
He and some of the others had a discussion in public on the Bitcoin Talk forum where Satoshi said, if only we could encrypt the transactions in the blockchain, and we could do that if only we could prove that the encrypted transactions are still correct. They're still following the rules. They don't forge money out of thin air. Nobody can give money to someone and then also give the same money to someone else, etc.
Satoshi alluded to a theoretical technology that could be used to solve this problem called zero-knowledge proofs. So what exactly is a zero-knowledge proof?
A zero-knowledge proof, this is a hard question.
Zero-knowledge proofs are a way to prove the truth of a piece of information without revealing the information itself. So why was this so important?
Zero-knowledge proofs can be used to solve the privacy problem in a blockchain.
Zero-knowledge proofs are the key to keeping transaction details private. When you make a transaction from your phone or computer, it gets run through a code that checks whether or not it's following certain rules. If the transaction is following the rules, it gets approved and then encrypted. Once encrypted, the transaction details are kept completely private. But in order to prove to the blockchain network that the private transaction is legitimate, the locked transaction is given a stamp of approval that everyone can read. This stamp is a zero-knowledge proof. It proves the validity of the transaction without revealing any of the private information inside. The encrypted transaction and its zero-knowledge proof are then sent to the blockchain network, where it's verified and added to the blockchain. Developers knew the privacy of users was essential to build a secure digital currency. But zero-knowledge proofs just weren't efficient enough to be used in a cryptocurrency. At least, not yet.
There's some really smart people who I like very much who've been writing papers about zero-knowledge proofs since long before crypto became cryptocurrency. But when it's actually being implemented, everything becomes harder.
We thought the hard part was just getting the core technical thing done. How do we use these zero-knowledge proofs? And then it turned out being, you know, how do we make them fast?
In 2013, a team of scientists from the US and Israel published a paper that explained how to make zero-knowledge proof cryptography efficient enough to be used for every transaction.
I found out about this paper titled Zcash, a scientific outline for how you could implement that imagination that Satoshi had had, where you could encrypt the transactions in the blockchain and add a zero-knowledge proof to prove that the encrypted transaction is correct.
So Matt Green and Ian Myers, two scientists from the paper, called Zooko Wilcox.
This cat's invisible. People don't even know I have a cat here.
To ask him to turn the Zcash idea into an actual cryptocurrency.
He called me, and I was so happy that he reached out to me. And he was like, we've been thinking about this thing, the Zcash idea. We'd really like it to become a real technology that anyone around the world can use the way Bitcoin is. I thought to myself, Bitcoin has a head start. Bitcoin is probably going to be the mainstream thing that everyone's going to use. If we make this thing and it's like a niche product, it's for the people who are the most paranoid about their security, and it's only used by, you know, a tiny fraction of all the users, then it won't change the world. You have to have 100 million or billion users before you're changing the world, right? So I said, I don't know if I can give up everything else I'm doing and just focus on this. Sorry, man. But then I slept on it. And the next day I was thinking, you know what? People need privacy for their own safety. If we did make this thing, it could become the mainstream thing that everyone needs all the time because they can't use Bitcoin for that.
With the combined effort of cypherpunks and scientists, the first digital currency to implement zero-knowledge proofs was born. They called this private and secure currency Zcash.
So I think what makes Zcash an incredibly interesting cryptocurrency is that it is truly a private currency.
I think truly private transactions are when you can transact with each other without requiring each other to disclose more information than necessary.
It should be basically like the default position that your systems and your preferences should be private unless there is a reason to reveal some piece of information.
So if you go into a coffee shop and you buy your coffee and you pay for it in Zcash, then the coffee shop owner finds out that they got paid, but they're not able to trace back, and nobody on the internet is able to trace back where you got your money and how much money you have.
So Zcash, the name is not coincidental. We believe the privacy brings us closer to the privacy you expect from cash, like an everyday person expects from cash.
Cash is a pretty amazing privacy technology, but it's horrible on the internet because it's not digital.
When we're sending transactions all over the world, privacy is necessary for safety.
The Handmaid's Tale, Margaret Atwood, she made this point on her masterclass, it was great. Never give up cash. She talked about how so much of what we do is digital now. You can always tie transactions to somebody, and you can also, with the push of a button, cut somebody off. In her case, in The Handmaid's Tale, that was a whole gender. Women could no longer have any freedom. They couldn't pay for anything.
It has been reported that if you are in Western China and you suddenly stop buying alcohol and cigarettes, you are likely to be investigated and you might end up in a re-education center. And the reason for that is, of course, the Uyghur population is predominantly Muslim, and a sign of devoutness or maybe returning to one's non-Han Chinese beliefs is giving up alcohol. The fact that that would be a metric that we start to judge our citizens on, and the fact that we get that metric from replacing cash with a centralized payment method, it should be all anybody needs to hear.
I don't want to see people adopting a system that can be used to surveil them. I want to see them adopt something that's trying to protect them.
Cryptocurrencies promise to fuel the next generation of innovation. And although its long-term potential is hard to foresee, one thing is clear. We have entered the next phase of money technology.
Techno-optimism is definitely something that I really care about. We have to have some kind of optimistic vision of technology and not just worry all the time about how it's going to turn into a dystopia. If you do that, then you know, you're going to end up not producing any technology at all, except for the people who don't care whether or not they're producing a dystopia. You just end up getting the thing you fear, but a little more slowly.
What if we could cooperate? What if we could interact? What if we could exchange from anywhere to anywhere at any time without our identities being relevant?
The scenario in which an economy becomes fully digital all the way down with privacy coins at the bottom and then everything built on top of that, that enormous explosion in the possibility and scope of economic trade and coordination. That's the sci-fi future. That's how we get the next step change in economic wealth and human flourishing.
I think a helpful way to think about it is to draw parallels from history. I believe it took forever for people to start electrifying their homes. When cars were first introduced, people said they didn't need cars. What was the cars for? I have plenty of horses. If one can transport yourself, couple hundred years in history and realize that then it looked crazy too, then today you can look at crypto and go, that's really crazy. But who knows, it might just work out.